Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Done in our country and right here in Alamance County, and we pray for your guidance. These things we ask in your name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Please stand for a pledge of allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. All right, next we have public speakers for today. We had two public speakers that signed up earlier electronically, Robin Plummer. Is Robin here?
Mr. Chair.
Yes, sir.
Robin is my assistant, I think.
She signed up for you, Dr. Lambert.
I think she did.
Well, okay.
We've got you on the list. Thank you, Dr. Lambert. We appreciate it, sir. And then Jeff Andrews. I haven't seen Jeff
I saw Matt, but I didn't.
This morning, so.
As far as I know, he's coming, but not here yet.
Thank you, okay. Mr. Williams. And we'll go to our list, Tony Cox.
See, God loves me. God said I was, y'all said I was third, God said I was first. We was talking about the last meeting about those protected polluters, danger, fumigation area. How would you like to walk out your door to that, Miss Massey?
Ooh, not.
Tobacco growers, look at that field. Critical watershed. Jason Martin said that was a fine line back in 2007. I love this article about the junk mobile homes. People can get help now with getting rid of those junk mobile homes. You know, a few weeks ago, I donated to the 9/11 Memorial. And I believe that from that good that I did, it come back over four times in that Mr. Webster needed help over there at the Register of Deeds. Couldn't get his plumbing drains unstopped over there. They was pouring chemicals in, that's what I was told, and they couldn't get them unstopped. So I went over there and unstopped them. Come back $875. All right. Here's what I'm going to do. I seen a newspaper article where these kids, these kids in the school want to publish a book about bullies. So here's what I'm going to do with that money. I'm going to set aside at least half of it, and I'm going to help them kids donate, make those books. And I'll tell you what else I'll do. If they'll talk about bullies in government, I'll give the whole $875, because the money's not important to me. I could care less, but I'll help those kids because they need help. They put it in the paper. So, therefore, good's going to come from good, ain't it? That right there, with it coming back over four times from that 200, it could come back millions on 875, could it? I love America and I love God. Y'all have a good day.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Appreciate it. Next we have Lash Reitenberry.
Good morning.
Morning, sir.
You know, I wish the first thing you do is change this meeting back to nighttime.
It's in consideration.
Because it's a lot of difficulty parking out here. But one other thing, I'm glad to see all these educators and education supporters here. But I wonder why they don't come to regular county commissioner meetings. Because we need a lot of support in this county. But the previous county commissioners, with the exception of Mr. Smith, put us in the mess that we're in right now. A lot of people don't realize it. We sold a prime piece of property down here on Main Street that should never have been sold. It should have been saved and used for a governmental center. We sold the beds to the nursing home along with it. Greg, you correct me if I'm wrong. Those beds brought in $435,000 a year. We're tearing down a building that I affectionately call the Sammy Epps Taj Mahal. We spent $274,992 out of a $275,000 budget to remodel that building for inspections and planning and zoning. Guess what? That's being torn down. I'm glad to see you guys up here, because I think you've got enough foresight to see what this county needs. And I do not understand the mindset of people that want industry in here that pays $40,000, $50,000, $75,000, $80,000 a year, yet they don't want our county employees to make anything. You never hear a thing out of the city of Burlington, the city of Graham, when they give their employees a raise. The county doesn't have the benefit of raising water and sewer rates. So you can't use that to give your employees a raise. Our sheriff is one of the lowest paid sheriffs in North Carolina. His chief deputy is one of the lowest paid chief deputies in North Carolina. Those two men right there, when they came into Alamance County, they took a sheriff's department that was down the drain, if you want to call it that. They've turned it into one of the top sheriff's departments, not only in North Carolina, but in this nation. But they don't get paid enough, neither one of them. But I support your budget. I support what you're doing for this county and for our county employees. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Reinberg. Next, we have Dr. Lambert, Dr. Leo Lambert. Welcome, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
I just wanted to come by this morning for a minute and commend the county commissioners and the school board for what appears to be a new era of cooperation and planning with the Alamance Burlington school system and thinking about a long-term vision for public education in our county. I think we all know that we're not going to get to where we want to be quickly or overnight. It's not going to be done in a year or two or three. But I'm very encouraged that a plan has been put in place, that we have a new spirit of cooperation to begin to think about how to move forward. And we have leadership on this board, on the school board, in the superintendent's office that I think is very, very promising. And all these, I think, are harbingers of really good things to come. I can't stress enough how supportive I am of the county commissioners investing in education. And I want to emphasize this word investment. I don't think there's anything more that we could devote our resources to as a community than in this next generation of young people that we're going to be depending on in so many important ways in the future. So thank you for your leadership. Thank you for this this change of course. And we're very, very pleased about the direction that we're heading in and look forward to years of progress ahead. Keep up the good work. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Thank you. Next we have Derek Steed. Welcome, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, commissioners, for this. My name is Derek Steed, and I'm Senior Vice President and General Counsel of Glen Raven. Yesterday, I had the pleasure of taking my daughter out to the Haw River to play in the water with our dog, and we came home with far more of that mud and water than I intended. But it did give me pause to recall that in 1880, Glen Raven was founded on the banks of that Haw River and ultimately moved into Burlington and has benefited, like so many other industries, from that stream of commerce at the Haw River, and subsequent streams of commerce, such as the interstate and our railroad systems have. And with that daughter, we have a representation to me in our public schools of an undercurrent of another stream that benefits business and industry, commerce and culture in Alamance County, and that is our educational system. And that I applaud, just like Dr. Lambert, the efforts to to look longer than just a one-year cycle into what the needs are for our future, because I believe, like many others in this community, that this vision of achieving excellence, where mediocrity is not something we continue to strive for, but we put to the side so that we can take this community beyond this decade and the next. And I want to commend to your attention that continued investment in our schools and in our children, and most importantly, in our future. Thank you.
Thank you. Jeff Andrews. Welcome, Jeff.
Thank you very much, and good morning, both Chairman Engel and all the commissioners. My name is Jeff Andrews, and I'm the current chairman of the Alamance County Area Chamber of Commerce. And I'm here to also lend my support to education, following in what Dr. Leo Lambert said and also what Derek Steed said. The chamber has a long history of involvement with education, quality education here in Alamance County. And in these last couple of years, we've kind of doubled down in that by getting involved with the vision plan. We have seen and reviewed the ABSS strategic plan, the Alamance Community College long-range plan. And I just want to be here to express the support of the chamber and the business community for education here in Alamance County, and just how important education is, I think, to economic development, to jobs, even to the quality of life of this county. And so on behalf of the chamber, we are asking that the commissioners support the increases in education spending, and just anything that you all can do to help education, and we think help business and help the entire community in Alamance County. I was reminded of a parable, and I hope I can get this right for you all, but the there was a village in Africa, and the fishermen started to notice that there were these young children floating down the water. And all of the village ran out and was trying to pull these young children from the water. And one veteran fisherman, an old-time fisherman, turned and started running upriver. And the villagers were all saying, you know, you got to help us, you got to help us. And he said to them, he said, pull out all of those children you can and save them. But I'm going upriver because I want to find out the source of this problem, and I want to stop that. And I think that's the situation that we have here. We can't keep be putting Band-Aids on symptoms. We have got to look to the source of these educational issues. And I would just ask that these commissioners, that you all, look to that source, and let's do some things that really support education for Alamance County. I thank you very much for the opportunity to speak with you all today. Thanks.
Thank you. All right, commissioner responses. Anyone?
Well, I got one. Number one, the Lash's comment about moving our meetings tonight. I would like to see us talk about that at maybe our next, not maybe not the next meeting, but one of our future meetings. I'd like to see that happen. And also to Dr. Lambert's comments, we're in charge of an investment up here, and the children are the investment we have to make our investment in, because they're going to be down the road. They're going to be our future of Alamance County. Thank you.
Well, I agree with Eddie, and I just appreciate all the educational leaders here in the room today supporting education. Very nice to see. Thank you.
I want to tell y'all, I went back to college when I was 50. And I have a degree.
I was 42, Linda, when I went back. I had tenured Elon College at that time, and that's what they told me, because it took me 10 years and I graduated finally. when I went back, if the classrooms were open, I was sitting in the classroom. You know, when you look at the county and the things that are going on right now in terms of, I have never, ever seen the interest countywide, the business community, parents, grandparents, just general citizens, educators, people in government that want to see us succeed from an educational standpoint. I think it started, the business community got together and the vision was done. Bob, you were part of that to look at the excellence and how we can improve the school system. Well, it went from that to a strategic plan adopted by the schools. As a matter of fact, the past commissioner board adopted the vision plan. They adopted it. So a lot of what you saw there from those businessmen was made a part of the strategic plan that the school system is following now. So as this board looked at that and saw that, we saw a keen desire and interest to improve the working relationship for the better of the county with the county school system and the community college and other governmental entities, and I think we have done that. With that in mind, I think what you're going to see is an improvement. That's what we need to see. We need to be able to put our hands on, this is what we're doing, and this is our successes right here. And the only way you do that is to work together. So I'm excited. What I'm saying is, right now, I'm excited about what's going on, and we need to just continue on in this endeavor. Thank you. Any further comments? All right. Move on to the agenda that we have for today. Any changes? I do have one change in the agenda. When we go into closed session at the end to look at the cases to get a review by our county attorney, I added Civitas versus Alamance County Board of Elections. I just have one or two questions. So that is added also, will be added to the motion. So with that, do I have a motion approval of the agenda as amended?
So moved.
Second.
So moved and second. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you. Consent agenda of members is pretty lengthy today. Is any items that any of you would like to see pulled from the consent agenda? Hearing none, do I have a motion for approval of the consent agenda?
Motion.
Okay. Have a motion, Linda, second by our vice chair. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you, members. All right, moving to our regular agenda, we have the presentations, and the first is a resolution in support of Connect NC Bond Initiative on November 2015 ballot. Ms. McCreary, Cheryl McCreary with the North Carolina Department of Transportation Board. Welcome, ma'am.
Thank you. Good morning. Good morning. I have the honor and the pleasure of serving with Commissioner Boswell on the Burlington Graham Transportation Committee. And that committee, along with the City of Greensboro, passed a resolution asking that the General Assembly vote to let the citizens of North Carolina vote on two bonds. So I brought a short presentation for you just so you can get a sense of where we're going. The citizens of North Carolina have these transportation assets. There's highway, aviation, bike and ped, ferry, public transportation, and rail. In addition, there's four additional assets: the Department of Motor Vehicles, the Global Trans Park in Kinston, two North Carolina ports, and the Greensboro and the North Carolina Turnpike Authority. Our transportation system is the largest asset in the state. There's over $47 billion invested in the transportation system, and if we had to replace it, it would be $570 billion. We drive over 104 billion miles in this state. We move 760 million tons yearly, and we spend about 30 hours in congestion. And just so to give you an idea, if you wanted to build 1 mile of highway, just one lane, that's $1 million. You build an interstate or a primary road, you have four lanes and the medians. So to build a road like that is about $50 million. Primary roads cost about half of that amount. And North Carolina is one of three states in the United States where the state is responsible for county roads. The other states are Virginia and West Virginia. So there's three states where we take care of county roads. This is a little bit of a summary of the Strategic Transportation Improvement Program. It's called a STIP. It's a 10-year view of transportation projects in the state of North Carolina. Right now, there are 785 projects to improve our highways, 829 bridges. There are 433 projects dealing with bike and ped, congestion mitigation, rail, ferry, safety, and some environmentals. We do 57 aviation projects, and we grant $1.9 billion in Garvey funds. So I know this chart's going to be a little busy, but you can go onto the web, any of the websites, and see this. The state of North Carolina can fund one out of five projects that the citizens submitted. There were over 3,100 projects submitted. We don't have enough money. You hear a lot of conversation about gas tax and automobiles becoming more efficient. North Carolina is not the only state that has a problem, this is one of our solutions. The governor is proposing two bonds. They're called Connect and See. And you can see from this map, each of the areas are divided across the state with some of the symbols of what type of project would be there. The highway bond is $137 billion. There will be 27 highway projects in there. Division 7 has two of those. Alamance County has one of those two projects. There are 176 paving projects. That means we're going to pave unpaved roads. And there are two projects in Alamance County that are targeted for paving of unpaved roads. And let's see. Those two roads are Woodbrook Road, also known as SR-1811, and Setter Drive, known as SR-1812. There are 57 counties involved in this. There is some job creation. It's estimated 12,751 short-term jobs will be created and 4,316 full-time jobs long-term will be created. And these projects were selected based on the mobility formula that the legislature passed 2 years ago, which has been phenomenally successful in North Carolina, to the point that we're way ahead of everybody and other states are coming to us. This is a summary, and again, I know this is a very busy chart to try and read, but this is a summary by counties, by state areas of some of the projects that are going to be presented. The second bond is an infrastructure bond. It's $1.48 billion. There would be two questions on the ballot for the citizens to consider. So if, here's some contact information for me if you have any additional questions. Are there any before I read the resolution?
Question.
Well, I'd like to just make a couple comments. Number yes, one, 119 was on that chart there. And also something that I gathered at our meeting with the transportation was what this does help move up some of the projects that are in queue to be on there 10 years down the road, may move them up a few years by using this money. And also we've tapped into some of the governor fund on our economic development in Hallfields, and I think one of the reasons I think the governor is pushing to get this on November's ballot is because interest rates are at all-time low.
Correct.
And if you're going to borrow money, you want to borrow low, as low as you can get it, and I don't see it coming any lower.
Right. So. Yeah, I think Janet Yellen has indicated a couple of times she's looking at raising interest rates. So. Right. That, just to be very clear, this resolution is not asking you to support or not support the bonds. All this resolution is asking that the General Assembly put this on the ballot for the citizens of North Carolina to vote on. So here is the resolution, and I will read. Whereas enhanced mobility across North Carolina's transportation network is a major factor impacting economic growth and job creation, and whereas addressing critical mobility and congestion issues across the state is dependent on all modes of transportation, and whereas our state's rapidly growing population presents critical infrastructure needs, and whereas our state has a long and successful history of judiciously using long-term financing to meet its infrastructure needs, and whereas it has been 15 years since the last general obligation bond was authorized to improve public infrastructure, which has resulted in years of deferred investment, and whereas no tax increases are necessary to finance bonds, given the ample debt service capacity within our existing revenue profile, and whereas interest rates are at historical lows and it has never been less expensive to make long-term investments. And then I will go ahead and read your resolution. I am not sure if you have it in front of you. Now, therefore, be it resolved by the Alamance County Board of Commissioners that the North Carolina General Assembly should place before the voters for their consideration on the November 2015 ballot the Connect NC bond initiative.
Thank you, Ms. McCrory. Any comments, questions?
Well, I think this is very appropriate and very necessary as well. And I love the term that Mr. Steed uses. It was streams of commerce. Transportation is one of those streams of
major
stream of commerce. And I see the need, definitely. And I even make the motion to adopt the resolution.
All right. Any further comments before we vote? Do I have a second?
Second.
A motion and a second that we vote to support the resolution that will be going to our General Assembly. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no.
Thank you, Sheriff.
Thank you, Sheriff.
Thank
Appreciate
you for your time.
All right. Moving to item number 27, Fire Protection Emergency Services Agreement between the Town of Elon and the County. Mr. Richard White, our Town Manager at Elon. Welcome, sir.
Thank you. Good morning, Chairman Engel and Commissioners.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning. I have the pleasure of serving as Town Manager of the Town of Elon, and over the past several months, the Town and Elon Fire and Rescue Incorporated have been working together to restructure fire services and emergency medical services within the Town of Elon as a town department. We're very pleased that July 1 will begin to make that transition, and I'm here today with our Fire Chief, Alva Sizemore, to request that you approve the Fire Protection Emergency Services Agreement on your agenda today. We're very excited about this transition within the Town of Elon and look forward to providing the best fire protection service that we can within our community. And so with that, we request that you approve the agreement that's on your agenda today.
Thank you, sir. Any questions?
I had a question.
Yes, sir.
Being new at this, I didn't quite understand. Is it currently like treated as a fire district and now it's being part of the City of Elon or vice versa?
Yes, it is a fire district. The way we've operated before is that Elon Fire and Rescue Incorporated, the volunteer fire board, has provided service within the Town of Elon and the rural fire district. Yeah. This will make the transition where now the town provides the service within the corporate limits of Elon and the rural fire district as well.
Yeah. All right. So is it being, does it get paid for through the normal fire district tax or
yes.
through the
yes,
Elon
it does.
Tax?
Yes,
it's
yes.
a
yes.
tax
yes.
on their so bill. Just
this,
like
on their,
this is just for the rural area that the district has been doing and now the town will be doing it, but it will not change the level of service. It will not change the amount. There's no tax increase asked from the district this year. So this really just puts operation from the fire board to the Town of Elon.
Thank and you. In fact, we've committed a combined budget between right. Elon Fire and Rescue and the town as well.
Thank you.
And I will say I do have concern about this, but especially with their new fire chief.
Yeah.
Something to consider.
I think we should hold this up for a couple months because he's planning to leave the county to go work. No, I want to thank Alva for Al Sizemore for his years of service for Alamance County, and we appreciate the opportunity to work with the town as well.
Yeah. For clarification, excuse me, Mr. White, Alva was with our fire marshal's office for many years, and prior to that, he worked with the Elon Fire Department, and he is well-respected in the community, and you made a wise decision hiring him as your fire chief, sir.
We are very pleased to have him. He's doing an outstanding job, so we're quite grateful that he's joined our organization.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate it.
Alva's got something to say.
Yes, sir.
I'm going to take about a second of your time.
Thank you.
I just wanted to publicly thank Alamance County. I figured this would be the best time to do it. I was 8 years in the fire marshal's office, and during that time, I really believe that the training and experience that I got at the fire marshal's office in emergency management helped me to do the job that I'm doing now. And I want you guys to know that you do not have a good staff at the fire marshal's office. You have an excellent, great staff. I've said it behind his back, and I would say it to his face. You've got a good man in David Leonard, and he brought me a long ways. So, and I wasn't looking for this job. The job found me. So thank you all for the years that you let me be a part of the county. Anything that the county needs, any agency that needs anything from the Town of Elon Fire Department, we're a team player, and we look for us.
Thank you, Chief.
Thank you.
Appreciate
thank
it. You. All right, Commissioners, do I have a motion that we consider the agreement and pass the agreement between Alamance County and the Town of Elon on fire protection and emergency services for the Elon Fire Division?
Make a motion to do that.
Motion.
I'll second it.
Second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. Thank you. Appreciate it. Thank you. Next, we have the reappointment of the tax administrator, Mr. Akins, who is walking in the door as I speak.
He was out doing rebounds, probably.
To make a long story short, Jeremy, I'm going to go ahead and take your thunder, and you're expiring, so we need to reappoint you.
Resuscitate.
Members, statutorily.
So moved.
Statutorily, we can do it for 2 years or 4 years, and I recommend that we do it for four. Judge, is that part
absolutely
of your motion?
Yes, sir.
Do I have a motion? Do I have a second?
Second.
Second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. No, thank you.
Thank you. I'm honored. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
That's
you're
tough.
Doing a great
he
job.
He made it,
though. All right. Pending legislation, Senator Webster, House Bill 477 and 516. Welcome, sir.
Chairman.
Yes, sir.
Madam Commissioner. Honorable Commissioners. I appreciate the opportunity to speak to you today. I had numerous issues that I need to talk to you about, but I decided since you would be so busy that I would just focus on the one that I think is the most important. And I want to congratulate the Times News. They got this article half right. The issue here is this legislation been introduced that would allow certain people to get their information redacted or removed from the Register of Deeds office and from the tax office. The two bills started out being identical in the House and the Senate. I call LEO, which I guess means law enforcement officers, protection, privacy protection. Now, this is a very serious matter because we have we have been moving toward having our records digitized, getting on computer with adequate backups. We have three redundancies in the digital records, and because you have to do that. Of course, on paper record, you can have a fire. God, please don't let that happen.
Don't talk about that.
But We estimate, and Cheryl Halichel, Assistant Register of Deeds, is back here. I'm going to ask her a question. We have maybe until the end of this calendar year in space for the what we call the land records, which is deeds and deeds of trust and other miscellaneous recordings. We're just about out of space in our vital records. Vital records means births, deaths, and marriages. All of these records are public information. The paper records are public information. The online computer records are public information. This past month ended Friday. We sent $249,077 over here to be deposited. That's a good month. If you had been in the office looking at the traffic in there, you would have thought the place was dead. But what's happening is that our recordings are coming in electronically. And we do the same thing with them now. But probably by the end of this year, this calendar year, we won't have any more room for the deeds of trust books. We just don't have them. Don't have the room. We are digitizing. We're scanning our vital records. Those we've been scanning at land records for years. But we have records that are ragged, dog-eared, worn out. You can't read them. And once we scan them, if we can get a good scan on them, that takes care of that. And you don't have as much handling and pulling apart. Up until just recently, when somebody came in to get a copy of that birth certificate, we had to pull the book apart and put the birth certificate on the copy machine and copied it either as a regular copy, an uncertified copy, which cost them 25 cents, or a certified copy, which goes on special paper, green, it's green paper with watermarks on it. We seal it, we put a compression seal and sign it, and that costs $10. Well, the proposal here is that certain people would be able to remove their names from the internet. Now, I don't know if y'all waste any time messing around with the internet, but there are websites, Mr. Chairman, that you can get anything you want to get. You can find out not only what Eddie's address is, you find out when he was married, why he was, it's just unreal how much you can find out about somebody. Not even going to the tax website or to the Register of Deeds website. Now, the origin of these bills was supposedly protection for these classes of people as a reaction to there was an assistant district attorney's father in Wake County who was kidnapped. They tell me it was she had gotten a conviction on a gang member. They said it was, somebody told me it was MS-13. MS-13 is bad news, huh? They may have gotten information from the tax office or the Register of Deeds office. They probably did because they got the wrong information. they, They kidnapped the wrong person. They didn't kidnap her. They kidnapped her daddy. And my point here is, number one, it won't do what somebody hopes it does. Number two, it will destroy the integrity of our system. Now, this means that you can't depend on the computer to do your research, to do your title search, because there will be pieces missing from that record, those records. Now, if you take a piece out of that puzzle, of that system, in my office, in the Register of Deeds office, you crash the integrity of the entire system. And I have said that if these bills, if one of these bills pass as they are, I will just take down the internet, which I'm allowed to do. That means that everybody doing a title search has got to come to that office over there. Now, that means that you need a building three times that size and a staff twice the size of my staff. Instead of 10 people, we need 20 people to deal with that, to deal with, and these lawyers and these bankers and these insurance companies don't want this to happen to them. Now, they're not saying anything. If you believe this article, the Sheriff's Department supports it, and all of the, this article talks like everybody in law enforcement supports it. Maybe they do, but they don't know what they're doing. And as I said, one thing that bothers me about it is there's a lot of animosity now, if you believe what you see in the paper, between some people and law enforcement and judges and DAs. There's a rising tide of animosity, Chairman Engel. To do a law like this that carves out these people and says they're entitled to a certain privilege will make that animosity even worse.
Have you seen the engrossed bill? That's the one that went over from the House to the Senate. You saw that?
I read them all.
Do you know that they've cut it down to this right here? This is it.
We didn't get that.
This is it.
Let me see. Yes. I can't read it from here.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, we didn't get that. The one we got was the one they started with, I think.
They've cut out the judges, the DAs, all that's gone, Hugh. It's just it covers governmental cell phones is all it covers.
Well, let me give you a little history. In the previous term of the legislature, somebody in the House took a Senate bill and stripped it out, took out everything except the bill number, and rewrote, which is a violation of the House rules, by the way, and rewrote it to put this bill, essentially this piece of legislation in it.
Yeah.
The answer to your question is, I haven't looked at that in the last two or three days.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, that's final result.
Final. It only pertains to government-issued cell phone numbers for law enforcement, sworn and non-sworn personnel, employee of a fire department, or an employee whose duties include responding to an emergency. That's all it deals with.
Records in the Register of Deeds.
That's the House bill, 477. Senate bill 516 didn't make it out of committee, so therefore didn't make it to a crossover. Now, in response to what you just said, you're exactly right. Sometimes what they'll do, they'll gut a bill and add a bill into the where they've gutted that bill and send it on. But there's ways to get around that. But
Chairman Engel, you had the fun, didn't you?
Yes, sir. I've been there. But I talked with Representative Rydell last night, and he feels that the bill that made the crossover, this one, that for law enforcement and cell phone, government issued cell phones, will be the one that the fact it's made crossover to pass it. But I think you're right in keeping us aware of this, Hugh, and what it will mean, and we appreciate the information, sir.
You know, Mr. Chairman, I appreciate you letting me know because
yes, sir.
I've been reading and checking on it, and I figured out recently that I need to talk with you guys about it.
Yes, sir.
Well, good.
Because I don't
want us to have to, because that's a mess when you start cutting into title searches like that.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Thank you for letting me.
Thank you. We do appreciate it. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you. Next, we have on the agenda is a proclamation in honor of Elder Abuse Month. And I'm pretty quick at reading. Let me read this proclamation, Elder Abuse Awareness Month, very important. Alamance County, North Carolina joins the world in recognizing World Elder Abuse Awareness Month every May the 8th through June the 22nd and World Elder Abuse Awareness Day every June 15th. And whereas national and international research reveals that abuse, neglect, and exploitation of vulnerable and older adults are grossly underreported, and whereas Alamance County, North Carolina vulnerable and older adults of all social, economic, racial, and ethnic backgrounds may be targets of abuse, neglect, or exploitation, which can occur in families, long-term care settings, and communities. And whereas the state of North Carolina enacted the nation's first elder abuse law in 1973, aimed at protecting older adults and vulnerable adults aged 18 to 59 with disabilities, and increasingly recognizes the need for a comprehensive system of protection for vulnerable and older adults. And whereas protecting North Carolina's vulnerable and older adults is a community responsibility, and all citizens are charged under state law to report suspected abuse, neglect, or exploitation to their local county department of social services. Welcome, folks. And whereas in fiscal year 2013, and over 21,000 reports of abuse, neglect, or exploitation of vulnerable and older adults were made to North Carolina's 100 county departments of social services. And whereas the Division of Aging and Adult Services partners with county departments of social services to offer a statewide adult protective services program with area agencies on aging to increase awareness about elder abuse through its long-term care ombudsman program, and with the state attorney general's office and others to assist victims in telemarketing scams and other forms of consumer fraud. And whereas by 2025, 86 of North Carolina's 100 counties are projected to have more people age 60 and over than age 17 and younger. And 1 in 4 North Carolinians will be age 60 and older. And whereas Mother's and Father's Days are national holidays intended to honor, respect, and promote the dignity and well-being of our parents, now therefore we, the Alamance County Board of Commissioners in the state of North Carolina, to hereby proclaim May the 8th through June the 22nd, 2015 as World Elder Abuse Awareness Month, and June 2015 as Elder Abuse Awareness Day in Alamance County, North Carolina, and commend its observance to all citizens. Signed this first day of June 2015, Alamance County Board of Commissioners, and it is signed, ladies, and I'd like to present this to you, and thank you.
Thank you very much.
Would you like to say something?
No, we just want to say thank you.
Yes.
Of course, we're from the Department of Social Services.
Ma'am.
I'm LaTanya Hall. This is Desiree Lewis McCall, and this is Bob Cothran.
Thank you.
So we thank you.
Thank
for
all of you.
Thank you.
We appreciate
thank
it.
You.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right. Moving on, and it's our county manager. You're up, sir. Budget report.
Saving the fun for last.
Everybody's here for the elder abuse resolution, right?
Yes, sir.
I don't think you qualify yet, Craig. So.
Thank you.
We'll get you one. Just
you'll get one.
We'll get you one. Relax. First, I'm going to do is let me thank you and the Board of Commissioners for the time and effort that we took to get to this point. And again, we had 2 weeks of budget meetings with all internal and external departments, and I think it was a really, really good process. So what I want to do first is read the conclusion to the manager's letter, and then I will go over the general highlights of the manager's recommended budget. I would would like to thank our staff for their hard work and dedication as we move forward with this proposed budget. We must always remember the purpose of the budget is to provide parameters for how we will deliver services to our citizens in the upcoming year. Last year, a tax decrease was approved. This year, we are recommending an increase of the tax rate to 59.5 cents per 100 valuation, and that's a 6.5 cent increase. With the first stage for the implementation of our paying class study for our employees, and again, this is the first update since 1999, and with the community commitment to help fund the ABSS strategic plan, many needs will be addressed with this budget. Also, with our continued support for our growing deferred county maintenance and capital needs at Alamance Community College, many issues need to be addressed. We have also continued trying to budget the necessary funding for capital for the operation of our basic services, from EMS, Sheriff, MIS, to updating and repairing our existing 500,000 square feet of county buildings. Our employees have had to learn to do more with less, as they have been inventive and progressive in service delivery. We have had some difficult times since the Great Recession with our past budget. However, I believe that the overall service delivery effects to our citizens have been small. We have been able to address our fund balance issues as many of our capital needs as we move forward into fiscal year 15-16. If you look at the operating budgets internally, 13 of the 22 that we have came in less this year at the request than 14-15. And really the only increase was salary and benefits. I would like to thank our finance department for the work they have done, and that includes Susan Roberts, our finance officer, finance specialist Rhonda Moracle, budget analyst Andrea Robbins, and and finance technician Brenda Murphy, as we begin a new process with the budget committee. Again, I appreciate Chairman Engel and the commissioners for the time and dedication that you gave to this process. It's important to hear directly from our department heads as the needs to provide the necessary, what are needed to provide necessary services to our community. With your input, I believe that we have a good process. As we discussed last year, we continue to place emphasis on fund balance. We've addressed capital needs as well as our fund balance within this budget. We have made excellent progress and will continue to become stronger as we move forward. We believe that this budget will allow us to meet many of the needs for the citizens. Many positive things are happening in Alamance County, from economic growth and development, which has led to greater job opportunities for our citizens, along with those companies, new and expanded capital investments in our community have occurred. We're basically getting back to pre-recession growth numbers. We have also seen strong growth in our sales tax, which is a very positive indicator for our continued retail growth and development in our community. Again, let me reemphasize this point. This is the manager's recommended budget. After this point, this becomes the commissioner's budget. We are here to reflect your wishes, and we hope this budget has. If it hasn't, let us know, and we will go back and address any of the concerns that you may have, and we'll make the necessary changes as appropriate. We continually strive to make and provide the highest level of services to our citizens, and I appreciate the opportunity to serve you, the community, and the best county staff anywhere as your county manager, and we present this budget for your consideration. All right. Let's get down to the meat and potatoes. Recommended budget and tax rate. $159 million budget. General funds $139.7. Landfill is 3.6. And again, as you're aware, that doesn't add up to $159. We have internal services, which include the fire department, our health insurance, which is self-funded, and also workers' comp. So that's all included in the $159 million. But the really ones that the board is interested in is our general fund and our landfill. And again, our tax rate that staff is recommending is 59.5 cents. And again, a 6.5 cent increase over this year's budget, which is currently 53 cents.
And again, 1 cent equals about $1.2 million. Major changes. We've talked about this a lot. Paying class. Again, this is partial implementation. This is not full implementation. It is a huge number. It's going to be multi-years for the paying class. When you do a paying class once every 16 years, there's major changes. So that's $3.7 million in salary and benefits. Service bonus, formerly called longevity. That is one of the things that the board has talked about that they wanted to see back within this budget. We're doing things a little bit differently with respect to the service bonus, and I'll go over that in just a minute. We have new positions that are requested. Many of those are in social services, but also we're upgrading some part-time positions to full-time as well. New capital, a little over $1 million. Education, ABSS, an increase of $2.8 million. And ACC of $341,000. And then outside agency funding. If you look at it, they asked for a request. It was about a 5% increase over this year's budget. Again, as I mentioned in the budget message, we had 13 out of the 32 departments that we have in the county ask less for their operating. And I really want to commend our department heads for that, because one of the big goals with this was trying to implement our paying class study. That's very important to our departments. It's very important to our employees. And we basically asked them and said, we got to come back. We got to make cuts. And they did. And I appreciate the work that they did to get us to this point. Again, paying class. Last paying class study was done in 1999. We're about 12% lower than market during this time frame. And again, the COG did this for us. This is just a sample representation of some of the counties they looked at. They looked at municipalities as well. But again, they're kind of the experts within our region in doing this type of study. They're the ones that tell us and who do multiple studies about what the market rate is for governmental employees in our region. But those are just some of the counties that we did look at. But we're 12% below our respective peer group. Paying class implementation increased the total salary and benefits. When you don't do a paying class study for 16 years, you've got a lot of reclassifications. We have 950-some full-time employees. Jobs change during this time. Technology changes. People leave. People go. So job classifications, job descriptions have changed. The 178 right now will better reflect what our employees are doing with respect to their responsibilities and respect to how they do their job. But again, 16 years for the new market minimum and pay grade. Here's how we kind of looked at it. We do have some people that have changed, and we want to get them at least to market minimum. And that's really a lot of the 178. They'll get more than 7%. What we've looked at is basically a 5% increase for those employees for the paying class, then 2% for cost of living. Because, again, a lot of these numbers were looked at in the fall of this year. Many of those communities are looking at a 2% across the board increase this year. So if we don't look at cost of living this year, we'll fall back. So we're looking at a minimum of a 7% increase for all employees, again, with some getting more because of the change in classification. And again, this is a multi-step implementation. This is not going to be done overnight. For some, we're looking at trying to get our employees to the median of their pay range. So some it's going to take about 7 years to get there, but there'll be a plan in place to get our employees to meet. Is there any questions on the paying class before we move forward? Service bonus, and again, this was something that the board has stated. We used to do it differently. We called it longevity, and that was paid out at Christmas. And again, that was based upon
a percentage of total salary. And what a lot of people looked at it was part of their base salary. Since they were getting that, it was kind of one of those given things. The reason why we were below market is because everybody was, you know, a lot of people were getting longevity. Longevity range anywhere from 2 to 4 to 6% of total salary, depending on how long you were here. What we looked at is really making this a service award, and really Craig Honeycutt's longevity should not mean any more than somebody in the tax department's longevity. My years of service should count just the same as somebody else's. So what we looked at is starting at 7 years. Again, it was originally at 5. We started 7 years, and we will pay somebody $100 a year as really a service award and a thank you for having them work for Alamance County and for their dedication. And again, once we reach 20 years, we will top that off. And the max anybody could get out of the bonus program or the service award is $2,000. And again, we would look at, instead of giving it out at Christmas, like we have done in the past, or the month of December, we will look at doing that on the anniversary date. One of the things that we've decided to look at and recommend to the board is if somebody's had a disciplinary action, that they don't get it. That we're only giving those awards and service bonus to people who have had no personnel actions within the current year. Again, we don't have merit, but this is something that will encourage our employees, and that there'll be some kind of risk reward for that for them as well. So this is service bonus. Any questions? Please stop me at any time. New positions, social services. This is IMC is income maintenance, and this is really based all off of NC tax. We have a lot of temporary positions now that we have that we're paying. This will make them full-time. The nice thing about this is they're getting reimbursed at 75%. One of the new positions we are recommending is a tax delinquent tax collector in our tax department. We believe that that position will really hopefully be a positive cash flow for us as we do a lot of delinquent looks within the tax department. Again, elections, voting equipment technician. This will start in October and work with the Board of Elections. They have somebody on now who's looking at retiring, who's looking at going part-time. Again, when you may have 5 or 6 elections during a year, you need somebody who can maintain and upgrade and make sure your machines are where they're supposed to be. We're also looking at adding an environmental health specialist. This was a position that was funded probably 4 years ago. It was frozen. We cut it out of the budget. However, the time frame is beginning to pick up with respect to well and septic permits. I think what environmental health would like to look at is about 2 weeks. It's now going a little bit longer than 4 weeks. So this is why we're recommending the environmental health specialist be put in the budget. Sheriff, one part-time deputy, one to full-time. We appreciate the work that the sheriff has done with respect to all of our court services. Thank you. But that has become really, he's trying to do that part-time position. We need a full-time position to make sure that we're adequately staffed there. Cooperative extension. As the board is aware, we had this conversation with the Farm Bureau, is that the North Carolina State is no longer funding the administrative position. We've been funding it half, and there's been a lot of discussion about wanting to continue the 4-H program within Alamance County, that we would pick up that other half, so as a county employee.
And let me interrupt you 1 second, and that's pretty much a wash, because they've got a position that they're not going to fill.
Yes, sir.
Mark was promoted, that
right.
Helps cover that.
Yeah. So those that you're exactly right. There's funding available from Cooperative Extension, and we're not going to fill one of those positions, but this will become a county position instead of a state position. Again, outreach coordinator with the library. Right now, that is a part-time position. The program really is going gangbusters, and she would like to recommend that be a full-time position. Capital needs, vehicles, 12 in the sheriff department, 1 in maintenance, 1 in inspections, 2 in recreation, and 2 remounts for EMS. Equipment, MIS, jail, EMS, dental and recreation. A lot of that equipment really is, we've had discussions about MIS and our IT technology and our backups and how important that is, especially when we have the crash. A lot of that capital is going to IT and making sure that we have the redundancy there. Capital improvement plan. This is year 1 of 7. When you have a 500,000 square feet of buildings, you got a lot of capital improvements. You got a lot of roof issues. You've got a lot of code compliant issues, boiler issues. You name it, you've got issues. This is the list that we presented to you during the budget discussion, and we're kind of looking at prioritizing. But again, we're trying to make sure that we upkeep with our maintenance so we don't have to come back at a later date and do a $9 million loan just to do maintenance and upkeep of our facilities.
This might change as we evaluate our facilities more in our strategic plan.
Yes, sir. But this is where we're at just today. Yes, sir. Budget reductions. Department request was 141. Manager's recommended was 139. So it seems like everybody may have got funded what they wanted, but they didn't. We have done a lot of cutting, especially in trying to put in the paying class and the increase for the schools. Education. One of the biggest parts of our budget is a $2.8 million increase. Request was 37.2. We're looking at 36.1. One of the things that we did add back in that we could have taken out was a capital outlay. We're going to, as the board is aware, we're going to use some bond money that we have remaining. We've got some lottery funds that we're going to clear out that we'll be using a lot of capital on. But we still felt like that we needed to put some within their capital. Again, this is just a little per pupil expenditure look from 07-08 to 15-16. Again, if you see, we're really not much above where our high was in 10-11. I think the next slide will show we're only 2.4. Whoops, I'm sorry. Wait a minute. Whoop! I thought it was in there. It's about, there it is. We're about 2.4% more than what our highs was in 10-11.
You don't have in there how that compares across the state?
No, sir, I did not. I'm sorry.
Can we go back to the slide? Yeah, that one there. So it's $2.8 million increase, but mm-hmm. as I recall from the school board presentation, they were asking $3.4 million increase.
Yes, sir.
We've made an adjustment.
We've made an adjustment within the manager's recommended. That's why it's manager's recommended.
Was there any line item changes, or is it just?
Just overall. It really was overall. We did try to implement, really, I think teacher supplement was a big thing for them, the increase in teacher supplement. So that is in there. But again, not trying to tell them how to spend, but it's just trying to say, how can we budget overall the increase in moving forward?
Just a question about process. Were you discussing this with the superintendent, Dr. Harrison, as you were coming up with this number, or just?
We've had multiple conversations. The final number, I don't know if we've had the final conversation about, but it may be just a little different than the final number. But again, I was wanting to make sure we put the $250,000 in for capital. But again, it's a $2.8 million, which is really almost a 2.5% increase there.
The main reason I ask is because, I really believe that when we fund something, particularly when we're talking about changes in funding, that we're targeting money to achieve certain objectives. And so the school board has gone through this process with the strategic plan,
yes, sir,
which if executed successfully will help us to achieve this vision of having a national model school system, which will be really good for all of us. And in that plan, it's very specific. These are the strategies that need to be funded at these levels in this first year in order to really put us on this track of achieving that vision. And so I get a little nervous they were very deliberate about it.
Yes,
and I just get a little bit nervous if we're not funding what's really needed, those specific objectives and targets in their strategic plan.
Yes, sir. No, and I agree with you. What we tried to look at is overall, and again, how that piece of the puzzle fit in with our overall budget and what we were funding other agencies like the ACC, because they didn't get fully funded as well.
Well, I would ditto my question for ACC.
But again, if there is a cut, it really is trying to look at how it fits in with overall philosophy. And again, if you look, it's still a fairly large increase this year. Also, we look at ACC. Let me see. Whoops. There's a per pupil. There's a comparison. There's a supplement change. That's what other counties do. That's kind of cumbersome. ACC requested $4.5 million in increase. We are looking at funding in $3.4 million. And again, that's still a $400,000 increase, over a 10% increase of what they were funded last year.
But they had very specific needs as well.
Right, yeah. Right.
Let me ask you this.
Yes, sir.
The teacher supplement, as you listed it now, is that just for classroom teachers, or does that include principals and assistant principals?
We requested for, I think what he showed up there just included teachers, but we requested for teachers, principals, and assistant principals.
I have a little problem with increasing the principal and the assistant principals supplement, certainly not the teachers. I'm very pleased with the recommendation for the classroom teachers. These principals now make about three times more than a classroom teacher in their supplement. And I just, I find that maybe they're worth it, I don't know. I really don't care. Classroom teacher to me is the ones who are teaching our children, and they are the ones that are so far behind in their pay. I've always supported them and will continue to support them. But at this point, we can't do everything that the school board wants in one budget. But we can continue to help these teachers and move them up. I think that's probably one of our basic problems. And I think the principals can wait for another year or two before we address that situation. That's just my position on the school budget. I don't have much problem with the rest of the school budget at all.
Thank you, Judge. I think, Dr. Harrison, that line item, and Craig, that line item wasn't that high, if I'm not mistaken, for the principals and assistant principals.
Yeah, what was that?
Pretty insignificant, so probably it may help maybe some for a board, Dr. Harrison, if that amount was found in another location other than the county commissioners, if that makes sense. It might help with our endeavor.
Well, it was less than $400,000.
Yeah, I knew it wasn't this.
And the percentage was a comparable percentage to what we were given the teachers as a supplement.
Yeah. I would like to say that I think that what supplements are paid should be based on what fair market value commands in order to be able to recruit and retain the best principals. And I understand Commissioner Smith's comments about how important the teachers are, and they are, in fact, the most important people that we have. But I also know the importance of frontline managers, and that's what principals in the school system terminology, I guess, represent in assistant principals. And if you don't have a good manager, then you're not going to have the motivated staff to get the job done. And a whole lot relies on the principals and the assistant principals. So I think we need to do what's necessary to attract and retain the best there, yes, to have a successful educational process for our kids.
Well, I noticed also you left out in your comparison with surrounding counties, you left out Randolph, Rockingham, and Caswell counties. Oh, Caswell may be in there, yeah, but Rockingham and Randolph, and theirs is, I think there's something around 5% supplement for each of them. Mm-hmm. It's just totally out of line. I can't accept that, but those three that you did list, of course, Chatham County is slowly becoming Orange County, UNC and Chapel Hill, and Guilford County is, they have a $1 billion debt service going on right now, so
yes, sir.
I'm interested in what they do, quite frankly. Otherwise, I'm okay there, Mr. Manager.
All right. Thank you, Judge. And again, that's ACC. Just an FYI, it does not include debt service on the $15 million. We're not selling those and probably until spring of next year.
Mm-hmm. Correct.
So debt service will be part of the 16-17 fiscal year.
Well, I think one of the bonds that was discussed this morning that the governor's looking at, I'm not mistaken, ACC would receive about $3 million towards capital.
Yes, sir.
Which would certainly help with replacing that
water line. Or yes, sir.
Some of the other things that need to be done over there.
Yes, sir. And then this is just kind of breaking down budget expense, public safety, 22%, human services 26%, and education 28% are our really big expenditures of where we as the county are putting our money.
Well, the education percentage is, if I remember from my commissioner's training that Eddie and I went to, as a percent of total budget is pretty, that's a pretty good percentage.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Very much.
And I wasn't too impressed with the percentage in the past when our tax rate was so low, but as a percentage of a budget that's being funded by a 59.5 cent tax, that's
right. And
it's reasonable.
The other thing within our budget is we did not receive any requests from fire departments, our volunteer fire districts, for a tax increase this year. So we told Alpha no. So.
Well, thanks to the fire department.
That's right. So, and that's it. Right now, the public hearing is scheduled for 2 weeks from today, 7 p.m. at the historic courthouse. If there's any changes that need to be made, again, this is manager's recommended. Changes, there's no expectation from staff that this is a stagnant budget and that this will be approved.
Let me ask you this, the fund balance, where is it in this budget?
We are looking at, right now it's 3.5, the same we use this year. We're looking at actually adding $1 million is kind of where we're at this year. So we use $3.5 million of fund balance in this year's budget, same amount for next year.
Well, where are we this year in that $3.5
million? We will add a million.
Add a million.
Yeah. We'll add a million.
Yes, sir.
So we will save that $3.5 million in fund balance?
That's
in this year's budget?
Yes, sir.
And you're just moving it over to next year? Okay, well, good.
I'm sorry. I should put a slide in that. I'm sorry.
Well, I'd like to say that I'm surprised that you got it as low as 6.5%
is what he's suggesting.
And others here might want to.
Elder abuse.
One way I look at this is that whether or not our tax rate is reasonable and comparable compared to other counties. So I know that the state average is about 64 cents.
Yes.
59.5 cents. It's quite a bit less than that. I know that all the counties that touch us, the next lowest besides us, we're the lowest, is Chatham at around 62 or 62.5 cents, if my memory
serves. Caswell may be in the 50s.
No,
Caswell is 67.
It's
67 and change.
Yeah.
Guilford is 77. Orange, which is the highest in the state,
88
is like around 88. Rockingham and Randolph, they're in the upper 60s.
I think you're right.
So we're still in really good shape from that comparable basis if we accept that recommendation.
We've got revale year coming up in 2017, and if you go back and look, in 2009, Judge, I think you were the manager then.
No, I was gone.
You gone?
January.
All right.
He saw that one coming.
Thanks, Judge.
Don't lay that on me.
My apologies, Judge, yeah. But the tax rate in 2009, just prior to the revale, was 58 cents.
And I may be gone for the next one, too.
I see where you are.
58 cent is what it was, and we're sitting here right now just before the revale, so that I think it might be some food for thought,
target,
maybe for,
possibly.
For all of us as we look at our budget for this this year.
Chairman, I'd like to comment on Linda and David for their implementing something that had been put off for 16 years with the wage study last year that y'all implemented. And I think our employees in Alamance County are the best, and I think we deserve to treat them the way. So y'all get credit for that. It was overdue. 16 years, a long time to look at where we stand.
Thank you.
Yeah, some folks think the current board did that, but it was done in September before we came on, but it needed to be done, and it is exactly right.
Well, let me throw the clinker in here. I assume in the major changes, $3.7 million to pay in class and $800,000 for a service bonus, that is in this year's budget?
Yes, sir.
You say that's just the first step, but that's the first step in this?
It's a major step.
$4.5 million of this budget is going to employees, right?
Yes, sir.
I don't know. I get the feeling that county government has been created to serve the employees rather than the employees serving county government. The county government has been set up to serve the people, and I really have a problem with that figure. That is just out in space as far as I'm concerned. I know we gave a 5% increase in this present year's budget last year. But this $3.7 million in salaries and benefits is just totally out of question for me, and it may just throw a clinker into everything, which so much of the budget to me is in good shape, and I do approve of. We, being the oldest one on this board, I guess I have to stand up for senior citizens, and I certainly do want to stand up for senior citizens in raising the tax rate to 6.5 cents is it's going to hit a lot of our people extremely hard, especially our retirees. Some folks are living on $1,200 a month, and for everything, and raising, if they own their property, if they're renting, they're going to get an increase in their rent payments. I just think it's too much, so it's going to affect our small businesses in this county. Businesses are trying to get started. Young couples are trying to get started in their lives with young children, and all of that goes with it. Great. I mean, we can sit here and say, fine, you know, let them eat cake, but that's ridiculous. And something's got to be done in this particular case. That's just totally over and above
right.
anything that I think this county is going to accept.
Yes, sir.
Quite frankly.
If I could, the increase that the employees got last year was if you received longevity. You know, we tried to incorporate that half a saving back into base salary. So part of our employees who qualified for longevity only got 2.5% increase, and then others didn't get anything. So we gave 3 bonus days last year.
And we gave a 5% total increase across the board.
Not last year.
Well, the year before?
Year before we did, but if you remember,
the year before.
The year before that, we've had about 5 years of no increases, right. or 2 years we had furloughs. One was 3 days and one was 5 days.
I understand that, but that's the private right. sector out here, they didn't get a 5% increase and probably haven't had an increase. If you have a job, they didn't get an increase for 8 or 10 years.
Yes, sir.
So I think the comparison is the same.
I think the key is also to go along with what Judge is talking about is we haven't seen the pay study plan.
Right.
And it probably would help us to know where we do stand,
right.
Mr. County Manager, right. in this endeavor that we're working on right now. If we had that,
right.
then we would know exactly where we're at in terms of these increases that we're looking at in the comparisons.
Yeah. We'll be glad to get to that. The numbers have
been. Does the pay study, does that include what the private sector's paying also?
Yes, sir. There's private sector okay. comparisons.
Well, I agree with Dan. To me, the bottom line is that we need to pay what the marketplace commands that we pay. I really don't believe that that we exist for our employees. I do believe our employees exist to provide services. And I think, Eddie, you mentioned at another meeting for the EMT that comes to save us when we're having our heart attack or when we're in our car crash, we want the very best EMT we can have. And we have a staff full of professionals, and they do really good work, and from social workers to sheriff deputies to social workers and DSS to just go down and look at all the wonderful departments we have in county government, and those are the people that are carrying out the work of government. It's not us here.
It's
the staff of our county. And so we need to make sure that our pay plan is fair and equitable and that we're able to attract and retain the best that we can.
And we'll get that information to you. And I do apologize, and this is part of the lateness for this budget, is those numbers have been
trickling in,
and they've been massaged and looking at options. And so when you try to implement it all at one time, when you try to do an implementation plan for all employees, instead of looking at a third, what many communities do, they do it a third at a time. You know, a third is done this year, a third is done next year, a third is done the next year. But since we've not done one for 16 years, the board at that time said, let's do it all at one time. So that's kind of how many total employees have we looked at?
900.
Yeah, 900 is kind of massaging where everything is. And 160-some reclass.
Okay. Any further comments?
Twiddling.
We will wait. Yes, sir.
Thank you.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Be prepared on, ladies and gentlemen, on June the 15th.
Right. Bring your support for what your college is.
Next, we have the appointment to the Alamance Community College Board of Trustees. It's my understanding that we have 3 applicants. I hope that you had the opportunity to look at all 3 members. There is one typo that's on one of the applications, and that's where our general, and it's very important, but our general that has applied, Blake Williams, he is not a convicted felon, so that is a typo. He would not have been a general unless he did that. So. But with looking at the 3, we have 3 outstanding applicants with Blake, General Williams, and also James Hooks, who is on the Mebane City Council, and Lisa Pennington from the hospital and Cone Health, and all were very, the second 2 James and Lisa are very active in the community, and General Williams, he wants to participate and be active. So that's what we have, and with that in mind, any questions about the applications? Well, with that being said, do I have a motion?
I'll move that we appoint Lisa Pennington.
All right, we have one for Lisa Pennington.
Chairman, I really like the general possibility of a general being on our ACC board. I think his armed service duties he's performed, I was just looking at his preparing 92,000 service members for mobilization. I mean, a man with that kind of background, I think, would be an asset also to working to put our veterans into the ACC college programs and to work on that side of it. I don't know if we have a veteran on that board, but I think it would be honorable for us to appoint somebody that served us in the military.
He does have numerous degrees.
Yes.
And both, like I said, both are very well qualified. Well, any other nominations? Then, with that in mind, I'll ask first, all those in favor of Lisa Pennington, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All right, we have one. All right, all those in favor of General Williams, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Four. Thank you.
Sorry, Bob. I like Lisa.
You can't lose on this decision because all three candidates.
It's amazing how qualified all three of the people are.
Very qualified. Very, very qualified, and we thank all three for applying for that position. All right, moving on to budget amendments, Health Department, Stacy.
Good morning.
So a few weeks ago, I had the pleasure of presenting the SOCH report to you all. In that time, under the substance abuse priority, we had talked about the Operation Medicine drop boxes, and at that time, Mr. Boswell had asked, were there any future plans of other drop boxes? And so today, at that time, I told you about there were some funding that may be coming to us, and today I'm actually asking for a request for a budget amendment for that funding from the Department of Public Health in the amount of $3,284 to be used for Project Lazarus, which we would be using for a permanent medicine drop box in our county, and working with a local coalition to determine that location.
All right. Thank you. Any questions?
I move that we do it.
I have a motion from our vice chair, second by Commissioner Byrd. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
And then the budget amendment for the emergency telephone system. Dexter, are you handling this? I see you coming in the door and walking this way. You better
come out.
You're going to present to us.
It's a good thing they saved me for last. Good morning, Commissioner.
Good morning.
Mr. Chairman.
Good morning, sir.
I'm standing before you this morning to request a transfer of funds from the general fund to the emergency telephone fund system. In your budget amendment, it reads transferring funds to emergency telephone system for ineligible expenses that the 911 board or fund would not pick up. And just so I bring a little clarification to that, this is for equipment that we have leased that is currently at Burlington, and also some equipment that we have at our backup center. So it was rolled into a lease and paid the whole lease, but the 911 folks said there are components in there that are not eligible. So I'm asking you at this time to transfer, or requesting that you transfer $52,312.05 from the general fund into the emergency telephone fund for that reason.
I have a motion.
I'll second that.
Second. No further comments. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
I did have one question. I know last time we were talking about working with Burlington on some of these backup things. How are we doing in that conversation?
My staff met with the city of Burlington, and in particular talked about some possibilities of sharing cable. One of the redundancies we're trying to do is run a second leg from this office over to the HSC. And I think they had a fruitful discussion with the city about the possibility of cutting that cost down by using some cable they have existing that may share with us. It was a good meeting. Yeah. I think they've
established a good working relationship, so we appreciate the tip.
Thank you for doing that.
Thank you. You got a vote.
There you go.
Yes, sir. County manager's report.
I've talked way too much today. I did that just for the judge, but I did want, number one, thank you and the staff for the help in getting us to this point. Work is not done. If you have any suggestions or if you have any questions, if you need additional information, please let me know. Please let staff know, and we'll be glad to get that for you. And again, you want to make this as representative of what you want as we move forward.
Thank you, sir. Is that it?
That's it.
Members, before we go into closed session, I'd like for us to just take about a 5-minute recess.
That'd be fine.
And then come back at 10:40 if we could.
Yeah, that'd be good. I make a motion we do that.
All right. Do I have a second? Those in favor, signal by saying aye.
Aye.
I would like to, we're back in session, regular session. At this time, I'd like to move that we go into closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute, Section 143-318.11A3, in order to preserve the attorney-client privilege between the county attorney and the Board of Commissioners, and receive a report regarding the following lawsuits: Natalie Jones versus the Sheriff of Alamance County, Randleman versus the Sheriff of Alamance County, Jackson versus the Sheriff of Alamance County, Thomas K. Manning versus Alamance County, Donna Lewis versus Alamance County, Department of Social Services, Holloman versus Alamance County EMS, Randy Byers versus Alamance County DSS, Alamance County EMS versus Penix, and Alamance County Fire Marshal versus Hot Z Food Transport Company, and Civitas versus Alamance County Board of Elections. I make that motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
Have a second. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All right. We are now in closed session. Thank you. Vice Chair Boswell will second. Those folks signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Now that we're in the back in open session, I do have an out of closed session. I do have a proposed statement to the public after closed session. The board considered and gave instructions to the county attorney regarding the claim set forth in Natalie Jones versus the Sheriff of Alamance County, Randleman versus the Sheriff of Alamance County, Jackson versus the Sheriff of Alamance County, Thomas K. Manning versus Alamance County, Donald Lewis versus Alamance County DSS, Holloman versus Alamance County EMS, Randy Byers versus Alamance County DSS, Alamance County EMS versus Penix, and Alamance County Fire Marshal versus Hot Z Food Transport Company, and Civitas versus Alamance County Board of Elections. No further action. All right, with that said, we now go to the commissioner's comments. Any commissioners have comments?
Well, I see our friend Chris Lavender's left us, but I saw it on Facebook last night. He is leaving us as of June 12th, and I just wanted to thank him, but he's not here to be thanked. So
we wish
maybe Thomas will give him a thank you.
We wish him well. I'll pass it on to him. And with any other comments from Commissioner? I do have one little item I want to bring up. There's some confusion as to the title of our clerk to the board. And it's coming from the fact that she's listed as clerk to the board / administrative assistant.
Or just administrative assistant or executive secretary.
I would like to just have if we could agree that she is the clerk to the board, period. If there's any questions, anything.
I agree. Absolutely.
Part of that with the duties is she is my administrative assistant, so that was the reason for the slash. But it, as long as the job description still reflects that, that'll be fine. I just want to make sure that that's in there. Well,
she holds a statutory position on this board, and she represents us. I told her myself, Mr. Manager, that she's responsible to us first, and you second.
Yes,
yeah, and I think, Judge, that's good wisdom right there. And if there's further to go along with this, as long as we understand the title, and then we'll, if we need to change something else, we will, and we can talk about that. So everybody's in agreement.
In agreement.
Any further comments from the commissioners? Then meeting is adjourned at 11:44.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building, located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is held at 9 a.m., and the second meeting is held at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel, beginning at 10 p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching Commissioner meetings online. For technical questions regarding this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of the commissioners' meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information on the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to visit the Commissioners' website, where you can learn about our Commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.